name is Jeffrey Rich, and I will be chairing this PhD defense. And I'll just explain very briefly the rules and how the process is here from here. So first, we will have a presentation by Chevalier, which will be approximately 45 minutes. And after this, we will have a discussion where the examiners ask questions. And as I've understood it from Izmir, we will do it in this way, that you focus on one paper where you all sort of ask questions, and then you move to the next paper and so on and so forth. The whole defense can at maximum be 3 hours, so this is our limit. Hopefully we can do it even faster than that. I think so. I would like to say then formally welcome to, first of all, Gabriel, coming here, defending your thesis. And I would like to give a special welcome to the main supervisor, Sigal, who has arrived from Israel to witness this defense. It's a pleasure. So, and then I would like to say welcome to the examiners. Ladies first, that would be Maria Börjesson from Stockholm, KGH, associate professor there. Jos van Olmon from, I have to read here, VU University of Amsterdam.
Yep.
And then Izmir Mulalic from Digi Humanities, associate professor. So, I think this sets the scene, and I think we are now in a position to hear the presentation. Okay?
Yeah, thank you for coming. So my title is very short, only 3 lines, like my name. So the title is of my PhD thesis is Consumer Behavior Towards Scheduling and Pricing of Electric Cars, a Theoretical and Experimental Analysis. And as Epe introduced, my principal supervisor is Segal, and my co-supervisors are Carlo and Alexander. The motivation of the thesis, electric vehicles are bring new opportunities for the transport sector, which is actually the only sector in having pollution steadily increasing. Potentially they use sustainably generated energy, implying that they may boost investment in generation of such resource. Second, they also emit less less pollutants than conventional cars do, even when the energy comes from unsustainable source. These are only 2 of the main advantages these have. However, they also present new challenges. For example, the recharging time and is a bit longer than usual. And the driving range is also limited, implying that recharging time and places are very severe issues. Second, they could have substantial effect on the electric grid system because they use electricity, which is not storable. And thirdly, I mentioned that there is still uncertainty about EVs, even though there have been a long time of discussion about them. For example, it's not very clear about their performance and their various driving environments. And also, the car resale market is not well established because they are new. Implying that the charging strategies and analysis of performance of EVs under various driving environments is very important. And the test addresses these 2 issues. The outline of the presentation will be that I will be presenting 4 papers that constitute the thesis. The first is the context of workplace charging, and the second and third thesis deal with behavioral issues that I have approached using experimental economics. And the last paper deals with energy consumption analysis of electric vehicles. I proceed to the first paper, which is economics of workplace charging. It is a joint work with Professors George, Segal, Carlo, and Stefan, and it is published at Transportation Research Part B. And it has been also presented at HERT and ITBR conference. Why workplace charging is relevant? Because it's expected to be the primary charging site for households without having private parking area at the home, because they don't have a place, their own place to install charging facilities. Second, it's also expected to be the main charging next to residential charging. And also, it is getting increasing attention. For example, the US government has been providing subsidies for employers providing charging facility. And as of January, there were about 1 million employees having access at workplace. However, we do not fund, to the best of my knowledge, a systematic analysis of workplace charging. And that's why this paper is important. So we address three objectives. The first is to propose an economic framework to demand, to model the demand for and supply of workplace charging. And then to examine if a market exists for workplace charging under the current market prices. And thirdly, we discuss some policy issues that may be relevant to boost workplace charging if it's important to do so. I'd start with the employer's perspective, the demand for workplace charging. We thought that there would be three stages of decisions. First, employers are not charging between different sites. For example, in the absence of workplace charging, we call it package H. They may allot charging between home place charging and commercial sites, depending on the tariffs. But when they are using workplace charging, they may allot charging between home and workplace, depending on also the relative electricity tariffs at home and at workplace. Implying that we could have different travel time. Actually, I don't know if it's a new term, generalized travel time, which is a standard travel time plus the charging time that is required to charge EVs at commercial or public charging stations. Because if they charge at home or at workplace, then there will not be any waste of time. In the second stage, consumers maximize utility or from consumption of general goods X from leisure and from travel, subject to money and time constraints. And third, they choose location of, charge one of the packages, whether they would like to demand workplace charging, and it depends on how the utility of workplace charging is relative to home-based charging, the other alternative. So if the utility from choosing package H, that is charging at home and at workplace, plus any preference for workplace charging is greater than the other alternative, then they will demand for workplace charging. So for computational simplicity, we assume that preference is uniformly distributed, but can be any distribution, and that we can compute the probability of choosing package H. By this, I proceed to the employer's perspective, that is the provision of workplace charging. And the employer may pay less for providing charging facility, or they may leave per unit electricity usage fee. In this regard, the labor cost will be the market wage rate that the firm pays to charging users. And this is the wage rate they pay for users. And this is the electricity tariff that the employers have to pay for providing the charging facility. And then we have a facility cost net of any subsidy that the employer may get or any extra exogenous benefit. We consider about four possible scenarios. The first is that, like parking, the employer may give free charging at workplace, or the employer may pay less, or the employer may collect per usage fees, but not wage. And finally, they may use both wage and per unit electricity fee to pay for the expense of providing the charging facility. And then we did some comparative statistics to examine the factors that may affect demand and supply. And we found that government could have impact through taxes and subsidies. And electricity suppliers could also have a role to play through the tariffs for firms, for households, and for commercial charging sites. And of course, employees and employers, and other factors as well, like those that affect the time used to call charge the EVs. We did some kind of simulation analysis to examine if a market exists given the prices. And To measure the employee's benefit, we use covalent variation, and we use producer surplus to measure the employer's benefit from providing carrying facility, and with data from Germany. We have variables on the first column, and, like consumption of general goods, leisure, mobility, monetary travel cost, general travel cost, value of time, utility, and probability of charging facility, the contrast, employee's benefit, that is equivalent variation, producer surplus, and also the net private net benefit. Then when we consider the first scenario, that is when charging is provided for free, obviously employees get, and we roughly get about 8 euros per charging day benefit, that is a cost saving from charging, as well as time saving, and also different substitution and income effects. And obviously employers will lose because, I mean, they are providing the facility. And in this regard, it has a net present value, I mean, net private benefit. However, there will not be market because employers will not provide the facility because it's costly. When we consider the second scenario, that is when wage discount is used or combination of wage and per unit tariff, and we find that employers will lose, and therefore they will not demand unless they have strong preference, whereas employers will benefit about 2 euros per employee per carrying day, and the net private benefit is negative, and generally it will not be offered, there will not be market because employers will not take over. And the last one is when charging fee, that is per unit electricity charging fee, is used. And in this case, we found a positive value for employees, whereas it is negative for employers, and the net private benefit is positive. However, still, there will not be market because employers will not be willing to provide. So overall, we can see that when there is demand, there is no supply, and vice versa, implying that there will not be market for workplace charging under the current price conditions. So what's the remedy? The remedy could be that if there is a strong preference from employees' side, and that the employer may charge them and there will be a market. Or second, if providing charging facility generates some revenue for employers that we do not take into account, for example, if it's increased productivity, maybe in the short run at least, or there has to be some intervention from the government, for example, a subsidy. And we found about 1,110 euro per year per employee subsidy for the employer to provide a charging facility for free. We also consider other demand side policy options like income tax, tariff, electricity tariffs, and others as well. But we thought that the subsidy from the supply side is better. So to conclude, the paper proposed an economic framework to model the demand for and supply of workplace charging. And the simulation result using the model in the market show that there will not be market unless there is some exogenous benefit or endogenous benefit. And third, we observed that employees obviously, and electric suppliers and government could play a role for the provision of workplace charging, and found that subsidies from employer side are more promising remedies to boost workplace charging. And we found also that there could be trade-off between subsidizing public charging sites and workplace charging sites. However, one major limitation of the paper is that we do not have the social welfare effects. I don't know whether providing charging facilities socially desirable. With this, I proceed to the next chapter. It's MOP close average behavior under ultimate MGM framework and the scheduling and pricing of electric vehicles. It is a joint work with my old supervisors, and it has been resubmitted for submission at publication at Transport Part D. Here, a mass EV penetration is expected to have a substantial effect on the electricity grid system, as I mentioned before. And the proposed solution from the literature has been to use time of use pricing. However, from literature in finance and investment, we find that, postponing charging involves some kind of loss or at least disutility of not having the EV ready in case unplanned trip occurs. And it is a recurrent decision making implied that there could be some kind of myopic loss aversion behavior. So the aim of this paper is to propose a behavioral model by combining myopic loss aversion behavior and ultimately MGM framework. And we'll do some laboratory experiment to validate the prediction of the model. When it comes to model, let us consider an individual facing a choice between consumption at time t paying equals to c, or consumption later at time plus delta t, and possibility of discount g that he proposed. Then there is a responder who may accept that proposal, or who may reject that proposal if g is deemed to be higher. If it is rejected, then the individual returns back to the status quo. But if it's accepted, then there is a likelihood of an event that may occur, and that the individual may incur an additional cost E with a net loss of S, and that it is worse, his or the individual is worse off when compared with the status quo. And there is a probability 1 minus A that he will end up with paying less than the status quo. So this theoretical framework, as you can see, the ultimate MGM framework is introduced here by the responder. It could be electric supply in the case of EVs. So we convert this into a mathematical framework and find that if we consider the degree of loss aversion and aversion to rejection of the proposal that the individual may think of, then we could have at least three solutions. The one is obviously the risk-neutral proposal, where lambda and beta is one, and that we could have the minimum expected cost, and we denote the value by gn. And second is if the proposal is a myopic loss averse and an averse to rejection of the proposal, and we denote the result by gm. By assuming some distribution for theta, we assume uniform distribution, we found that this proposal is either very high when compared with this one, and thus it will be rejected by the proposer, or it could he may propose less than optimal depending on the relative degree of alpha and beta. And the solution that we think of as the third result is, what if we lessen the myopic loss aversion behavior? From literature, lessening myopic loss aversion behavior implying that just we induce the individual to think is in aggregate. For example, if you consider daily charging, you may think that if I postpone today, my earnings will be about 20 kroner. I mean, it's not that very high compared with not being able to use my car. So he may discharge. I mean, he may not be willing to postpone. But when we provide long-term contracts like monthly or 6 months, then he thinks we induce the individual to think in aggregate. And we found that in that case, it can be shown that the effect of the degree of loss aversion will be minimum. So the theoretical model main result is that by presenting long-term contracts under ultimate MGM framework, we could lessen the myopic loss aversion behavior and make the individual induce the individual to make better choice, which could be very important for commitment of contracts. So I proceed to experiment on the validation. The objective is to investigate if enforcing long-term contracts under ultimate MGM framework contains myopic loss aversion behavior. And we use about 147 mostly students at University of Copenhagen. And the method is controlled laboratory experiment that participants were paid according to their choice. And the experiment basically constitutes two groups, the treatment group in that we informed them that their decision will be effective for 8 consecutive rounds, whereas for the control group, they have to make decisions on daily basis. Otherwise, everything was the same for the two groups, and we conducted the experiment using the D3 software program. And we did three scenarios, and the first is like the one that I mentioned in the theoretical model, that the participant has to choose between charging at 6 p.m. when he arrives at home and pay 100 tokens with default saving of 10 and no risk because he charges immediately upon arrival, or to postpone charging until 11 p.m. and ask discount for that, with to compare third chance of paying 110 for taxing. And the here we have the result. This is the amount of proposal, and these are the rounds of decisions. And the dot line, the horizontal dot line represents an optimal discount request by a risk neutral individual. And the green line here shows a proposal by the treatment group, whereas the red line is a proposal by the control group. As you can see, very clearly, there is a treatment effect, and it is statistically significant. And more interestingly, we can see that the control group experienced very clear myopia behavior. They were responding only to immediate causes instead of thinking in aggregates. And that they end up with paying a high cost when compared with the treatment group. And when I go to the second experiment, it is almost similar, but here we instead asked them to propose deferred charging time, implying that they are asked the same A, charge at 6 p.m. and pay 100, or pay 75 tokens and propose deferred charging time. That is the change in delta in the theoretical model. So the more they postpone the charging hour towards the morning, the more likely that their offer will be accepted by the responder. But it is also more risky that an event that may occur that they have to pay 110. When I come to the result, still we can see that the difference exists starting from the first round. However, like the previous one, the difference seems gradually, the treatment gradually reducing. And still, in this case, the control group here, they are not coming closer to the optimal. Instead, the treatment group first were lower, and then they approach the optimal, and then they keep on. Probably they misjudge the trend. And finally, we did third experiment that phase A is also the same as before. But in this case, we ask them to let the electricity supplier to schedule the charging. In that, the risk level wasn't revealed. Therefore, the decision-making problem involves ambiguity. And the outcome was that, unlike the previous two experiments, we found that the treatment doesn't help them, probably because it is costly for them to propose, given that they don't know the level of risk. So overall, the conclusion is that by combining myopic loss averaging behavior and ultimate MGM framework, we propose a behavioral model that could lessen myopic loss averaging behavior. And the experiment results are constant with the predictions of the model, except the case of ambiguity. And presenting the contrast then could be better in long-term terms than merely an outing time of his pricing of electricity. I proceed to third paper. It is using perifects in scheduling and pricing of electric vehicles. It's a laboratory evidence as well. The motivation of this paper starts when I get a letter from Dawn Energy that applies energy, stating that I could compare my energy consumption with other subscribers. Then when I see the cost, I found that I am one of the lowest within the 10 percentile. And then I thought about why they send it to me. And I feel two opposing factors. First, I pay less because I feel better because I pay less, one of the least price. But I also feel that, I feel also some kind of distaste that why my electricity consumption is very low. Maybe there's something I missed, so I feel kind of dissatisfied. And then I started asking some questions, like, do people usually need to see the choice of others? And to what extent that we can influence the choices of individuals, given that the choices of others may not provide any important information? And then I ask about a comparison between providing a choice of a peer versus providing the choice of a population representative. And then I ask about comparing the peer effect when we give individuals by default and when the individuals choose by themselves. Is there any treatment, I mean, their effect. And finally, examine if lack of self-confidence and analytical ability could contribute to the perifect, because we assume that everybody is maximizing his own utility. So why, if they maximize their utility, why are they being influenced by others? So this is an experiment, and the aim is to give insights about perifect in EV charging, and it is also a laboratory experiment. The task of the participants was to decide the amount of electricity to buy by paying 10 units per kilometer for EV driving, given that the electricity tariff will be zero between 9 p.m. and the following day, 6 p.m., and given that they have enough battery to arrive at home, but there is no any other energy if unforeseen trip occurs, and the distribution of unforeseen trip is between 0 and 60 kilometers. And they were informed that if unforeseen trip occurs and they do not charge, then they have to pay 15 cents. And still, we have two treatments, the control group and the treatment group. The control group, they receive no information so that we can compare with, whereas the treatment group, they receive prequest information. The samples were 215 students, mostly master students, with average age of 25. So, do people want to see the choice of others? Yeah, the answer I found is yes. Even though the information was complete, that seeing the choice of others doesn't convey any new information, I still found that people are interested to see what others are choosing. And in the first round, when I asked them the first time, 79% of individuals say that they would like to see the choice of others. And when I repeatedly asked them, the percentage expectedly declined to 58 when the fourth round. And from logic estimation, I found that education level and ability and experience have negative effect. It means more experienced participants are not that interested to see the choice of others. And found that self-confidence and women intended to see the choice of others more. I'm surprised that not all participants choose to see the choice of others, because it was free, and yeah. But I discussed the paper why there could be some factors. Then I examine any effect of providing the choice of others. I mean, the experiment procedure was that I first ask them to make a choice. Then when they make a choice, they didn't know whether they would be receiving peer information. Then a random number draw determines whether the participant was to receive peer information. And then if he gets the peer information, he was asked or she was asked if you would like to change their initial choice. And I found that this is the control group who would not, who would not receive any choice information. And this is the treatment group. Initially, the control group choice was closer to the optimal one. But I didn't find statistically a difference between the two groups before any of them received peer information. But once after I give peer information, then the treatment group declined gradually, the choice of the treatment group, actually towards the optimal value. Whereas the control group, they keep on increasing, sometimes go up and down. And generally, I found statistically significant peer effect. And overall, about 6% of the participants reduced their choice on average by 10 units after observing that their peers' choice was less than their own. And on the other hand, about 6% increased their purchase by, on average, 12.5 units after observing that their initial amount was less than their peers. Actually, this group became better off after the peer information, and it became worse off, I discussed that also in that paper. Next, I examined the percentage of participants who were influenced by the choices of others. And in the first round, 27.9 participants revised their initial choices after observing the choice of others, and the percentage gradually declined, sometimes go up and down. And more interestingly, I found that among those influenced, 79% of the peer effects were observed among participants who answered less than half of about 8 math questions that I asked them. They were simple math questions. And this group, I mean, those who answered about half consists about 52%. Therefore, we can see that those who have maybe analytical ability were more influenced by the choice of others. And from Logity and Poisson model estimations, I found that analytical ability has a statistical significant effect both on the probability of being influenced by others and also the amount of change on initial choices after seeing the choices of others. Then I found the, I asked another treatment. I mean, I considered it is a treatment between population equality and population as they appear. In this case, everybody received the main choice of the participants in the session, but one of the groups were informed that this information is a choice of appear, whereas the other participants were informed that this is a choice of a main choice of the participants. Therefore, the difference, the only difference between the two treatments was that one is framed as a choice of a main choice of others, and the other is framed as a choice of a peer. So here, the red dot line represents the control group, and the green line, the population treatment, that is who receives the main choice of others, and the blue line represents the blue line represents the population, the green line population treatment, the red line the population as a peer treatment, and the blue line was the control group. And as you can see, there is a very clear treatment, framing effect. Those who received the choice as mean choice of others gradually reduces their choices towards the optimal value, whereas others do not change. Overall, I found a statistically significant effect, and thus providing the mean choice of participants could be, the mean choice of the population could be more informal, more effective in terms of inducing peer effect than providing the choice of a peer. Then I also examined two treatments. One, I matched individuals based on their risk preference. The most risk averse was matched with the most risk thicker, and the second most risk averse was matched with the second most risk thicker, and so on. In another treatment, they get the mean choice of others by framing as if it is a choice of April. So the idea here is that if individuals are imitators, if I'm copying the choice of others, then it is always better to provide the mean choice. And that may reduce the sample divergence because everybody is imitating. Whereas the second treatment will not have any effect on the sample divergence because the risk seeker will take the risk averse choice and vice versa. So in this experiment, I found that except on the first round, when I matched them based on risk preference, I found higher peer effect than when I match them. When I give them the choice of a peer. Therefore, the idea here is that individuals, I found that generally they do not imitate the choice of others. They trade off between their own instrumentic choices and their preference to confirm others, and they monotonically approach the choice of others instead. Therefore, in this regard, if we have a target optimal value, it might be better to give a bit higher than the optimal, but in the short run, at least, it could induce higher gain. The conclusion from this paper is that I found that most people would like to see what others are choosing, and a moderate number of participants also are influenced, even though the peer information doesn't convey any new information for them. And I'd not found statistically significant difference between providing peer information by choice. For some of them, I asked them if they would like to see the choice of others. For the others, I gave them by default. So in this, between these two groups, I didn't find any statistically significant peer effect. Third, I found that providing the mean choice of others, like the population average, could have higher peer effect than a random individual as expected. And the other conclusion I reached is providing the choice of others may improve or reduce the genes of others depending on the position of the peer with regard to the optimal value. Therefore, it could be it could be beneficiary to selectively provide peer information instead of, for example, sending the distribution of the population. Yeah, for example, Dawn Energy, the energy that supplies circuits in Denmark has been providing the distribution in that regard. It may have, those who are consuming higher may tend to, they may like to reduce, but they may have adverse effect on from the bottom side. They may think that why they are consuming less. So I don't know if they also consider increasing. In some experiments, they found a positive effect. The last paper is about harnessing big data for estimation of energy consumption of electric vehicles. And it is a joint work with Carlo, Segal, Stefan, and Anes. And it's a slightly modified version of the paper submitted in Transport Research Part D and has been presented at TPR. So studies about electric consumption of electric vehicles under the hands, in the hands of customers is very important for consumers to make informed decisions because there is still uncertainty about the performance of EVs under various driving environments. And it could also be also important for manufacturers to provide more reliable information for their customers living in different environmental areas. And it could be also important for government to introduce appropriate tax policies. So this study examines energy consumption of fully electric vehicles and its determinants under the hands of customers. We use four data sources. The first is a detailed driving account of about 741 drivers, which is collected by CleverAct, that's a mobility provider. And the data was collected between January 2002 and January 2014. And the vehicles used were Citroën C0, Peugeot Leon, and Mitsubishi. Technically, they are the same. And we also collected some EV drivers' household data during the car renting time. And through data matching, we also have road type, like whether it's a highway or not. And we get detailed weather data from Danish Metropolitan Institute. So how to measure electric vehicles' performance? There have been different measures. In this paper, we just computed energy consumption rate, which is given as energy consumption. That's watt in hour or kilowatt in hour divided by distance driven. And to estimate the determinant of energy consumption, we ran a fixed effects model because it was panel data. So the results, an overview of the trips, on average each driver had 3.4 trips, but by this paper, by this data, trip implies from the switch, the car is switched on to the car is switched off, so it might be, the large number of trips shared could be because sometimes I may drop by somewhere to buy something and we continue our journey, so that has to be taken into account. But most of the trips were less than 5 kilometers, and those with greater than 50 kilometer connected to only 1%. And we observed that individuals usually recharge their EVs using only about 44.5% of the battery. So if we first compute the average energy consumption rate of electric vehicles, and we found that it's very heterogeneous, as you can see here. For example, the 80% of the energy consumption is between 130 and 274. It is a large distribution. And the mean energy consumption for the vehicles under consideration is 183. And usually, it is by far much higher than predicted by, for example, a new European driving cycle test. Actually, they estimated the maximum. And we found that only 7% could achieve the maximum driving set by, they found, the maximum driving they found. So this competition of energy consumption is important, for example, to roughly we can compute whether which EV to buy related to conventional cars. I just make an example here. Driving this EV will be cheaper than conventional car in terms of fuel energy. For example, if the driving, I mean, the fuel in, consumption of conventional car is greater than 16 liters per kilometer. Of course, assuming 9 kroner per liter fuel cost and 3 kroner per kilowatt electricity. So we can make a difference there. When it comes to energy consumption by season, here the red lines, bars show energy, mean energy consumption during the month, whereas the black bars show the temperature, and we can see that there is very strong weather effect on energy, I mean, on the performance of electric vehicles. For example, the energy consumption in December was almost 65% higher than the energy consumption in August or in July. On average, we found that there is about 39.5 energy consumption difference between summer and winter. When we come to the determinant of energy consumption rate, we found that speed has a U-shaped effect, implying that driving too fast and too low could be is costly, and acceleration has an increasing effect. It increases, I mean, energy consumption increases at an increasing rate, whereas trip distance has a U-shaped effect. And winter demi, even after accounting for different weather variables, has still a strong effect, maybe because of some other factor that we do not account, like ice on the street, we do not measure that. So overall, we find that energy consumption rate of electric vehicles is heterogeneous. It is highly affected by, for example, weather and driving cycle, particular style, particular speed and acceleration. And find that trip distance, temperature, and speed of driving have a linear U-shaped effect. And energy consumption could be, in winter, could be as high as 60% in summer, implying that there is huge huge energy consumption difference between the weather conditions. And ceteris paribus, we roughly found that driving energy consumption low when the temperature is about 29 degrees centigrade, and the driving speed is about 45, but it will be affected a number of factors, so it cannot be controlled by the driver. And we do not find a statistically significant difference between trips on highways and in highways. That's it. I think I finished moving faster. Yeah.